the internal auditor at South Dakota State University in the finance and administration office. So I'm essentially helping management ensure that they have a strong governance, risk management, and control processes. So I've been there about a year and a half, and so now Kristen and I live here in Brookings. So again, happy to be here and look forward to getting to know all of you in the coming weeks and months. Thank you.
Yeah, he's pretty great, right? Well, it is good to be with you and worshiping together on this July 4th holiday weekend. I hope that it has been a great time in whatever way we could celebrate in this unique time that you were able to enjoy this Independence Day holiday. And then to be together in worship is a special treat and blessing. So welcome. Welcome to us all. I want to invite us to stand as we join in our call to worship. It is for freedom that we have been set free. Let us worship now in spirit and truth the God who makes us free. And I invite us to remain standing as we sing together Jesus' name above all names. Let's sing. Be seated. Would you join us? Join me in prayer. Let's pray together. Gracious, holy, loving, liberating God, we worship you this morning. You are the God who sets us free. Gracious God, you freed the Israelites from bondage so long ago to slavery, walking them through deep waters into freedom. Freedom and struggle, and long journeys to which they didn't always know the end, and yet they were free in the midst of all of that. Lord, you freed the woman at the well from her shame and her guilt. And you free all of us through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, who died and rose again for our freedom from sin and to eternal life. Lord, we're so thankful on this weekend for those who have fought for our freedom as a nation, that we are free to worship you today. It is a gift and a right not afforded everyone in this world, and so we are so thankful for those who protect and preserve that freedom. And Lord, at the same time, we confess that we realize that that freedom that is so precious to us has not been equally shared. We grieve, Lord, the times that we have fallen short of the dream of liberty and justice for all on which this nation was founded. In recent weeks, it has been so clear that while we have come so far, we still have work to do. And so, Lord, we confess that. We confess times when we have put our needs above the needs of others, and we've allowed our convenience to outstrip, perhaps, our care for our neighbor. Oh, Lord, we are grateful for freedom. We know that you have given us freedom to help us to be part of making others free as well. And so we thank you, Lord. And even as we take these moments to confess those times when we have fallen short, we are so very aware of your grace that covers our sins, that brings us back into relationship with you and with others. Your grace is sufficient, Lord, for all of our needs, all of our worries, all of our struggles. Through Christ, we have all been set free, free to love, free to serve, and free to worship. We accept with great gratitude that gift of freedom by the grace of Jesus Christ that has been given to all of us. In Jesus' name, and together we say, Amen. Our scripture reading this morning comes to us from the book of Exodus, chapter 3. Verses 1 to 4 and then 1 to 5 and then 9 to 14. Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in the flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt. And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here I am. And he said, Draw not nigh hither, put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. And then verses 9 to 14. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppress them. Come now, therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And Moses said unto God, Who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh, and that I should bring forth the children of out of Egypt? And he said, Certainly I will be with thee, and this shall be a token unto thee, that I have sent thee. When thou hast brought forth the people out of Egypt, ye shall serve God upon this mountain. And Moses said unto God, Behold, when I came unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, The God of your fathers hath sent me unto you, and they shall say to me, What is his name? What shall I say to them? And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am, hath sent me unto you. This is the word of the Lord for us this morning. We're grateful for it. I would invite us again to stand as we sing Only Jesus. Let's sing together. Thank you.
Make it count, leave a mark, build a name for yourself. Dream your dreams, chase your heart above all else. Make a name the world remembers. All an empty world, sell his empty dreams. Got lost in the light, and it was up to me. Make a name the world remembers. Jesus is the only name to remember. I don't want to leave a legacy. I don't care if they remember me. Only Jesus. And I've only got one life to live. Kingdoms built, all the trophies won, crumble into dust when it's said and done. Is all that really matters? Did I live the truth to the ones I love? Was my life the proof there is only one whose name will last forever? I don't care if they remember me, only Jesus.
As we come together to worship, we've all put our masks on and we're all sitting a little bit apart from each other. We just want to thank you, church, for your faithfulness in doing that. It has been peaceful. We have all come together with a common spirit to care for our neighbor. And that's wonderful. What an example we're providing as a church of how we do that. So thank you for that. It is a different thing to sing with a mask on, but it is a safe thing to do in these times. So thank you so much for that. And one of the ways that we're going to try something a little different is with our passing of the peace. And normally, it's such a great time. We get to shake hands and hug people and talk and say, how you doing? It's going to be a little bit different today. I've been thinking about it, and I talked with Pastor Pete about something that we can do to preserve this wonderful tradition and yet to do it in a way that's safe. So I'm going to ask Pastor Pete to come. And we're going to demonstrate this. We're going to ask you to do this first on your left and then to your right. So within family units, you can stay close by, but we ask that you'd remain in these family units and not kind of wander over to each other, just to be on the safe side. So this is what we're going to do. We're going to cross our hands over our hearts like this as we turn to our left and our right, and then we're going to reach them out to our neighbor and say, "Peace be with you." And all those things that we might have done with our hands and our arms, let's do with our eyes and with our faces, because you can see smiling eyes even with a face mask on. So first, I'm going to display. We just cross our hands over our hearts and say, "Peace be with you." All right. So that's how we do that. I'm going to invite us to turn to our left first. And then let's say, "Peace be with you." It's good if you're laughing. It's fine. This is new. It's different. All right. And then we can turn to our right and say the same to our neighbor. "Peace be with you." Wonderful. I wish you could all see what I'm seeing up here. That is great. Thank you so much. We invite you to have a seat as Pastor Pete brings the message this morning.
If I could add to Teresa's words, gratitude to all of you for being willing to work with us in this experiment of how do we worship together but apart. A huge amount of thinking went into today. We have a small team that's been working on it. I want to say thank you. Bunny, won't you stand up for a moment that people can see you? Bunny is kind of our chief advisor in the process. She advises a whole lot of other groups in the city as well. But thank you for giving us your time. Bunny has given us advice on how to clean the buildings, and we've engaged our cleaners that the cleaning products we use are the correct cleaning products. And she has helped us in the ordering and making sure that this place is cleaned properly. And we want to thank you for the time you put in there. And then you've been our advisor on the small committee that asks, how can we do this safely? And if we can just express our gratitude to you. The last thing we want is that you guys come to a service, and then in a week or two's time, you're sick, and you say, we went to church. And it's not that we don't have faith. Of course we have faith. I suppose I could ask in the same way, do you put your seatbelt on? Don't you have faith that, you understand where I'm going? There's a sense in which God has given us capacity to think and expects us to think logically through some of this stuff as well. So thank you for being willing to be part of this. I have a friend who's just started as the pastor in First Methodist in Watertown. She was here 2 weeks ago. She shared the Father's Day service with me. But Jen sent me a message this morning wishing us well for our first in-person service, and kind of added, and I hope you have a small turnout, which has been part of our hope, because this is an experiment. We're going to meet again in the week and look at how this went and ask what we can learn from it. If you have any ideas, please feed your ideas back as well. If anyone sitting at home has any ideas, please feed them in. Matt Miller is chairing that committee. Send all your ideas to Matt or send them to me. It's awesome to meet with people, but we want to do it in a way that's sensible and in a way that preserves everybody else's integrity as well. We are following the Lord's Prayer. There is a booklet that I've written. If you haven't picked one up, you can pick them up at the information desk on your way out, or alternatively, you can come during the week and pick it up from the information desk in the narthex. So far we have covered our Father. Last week we looked at who art in heaven. This week we move on. I'm getting feedback here, Sam. Oh, Paul, thank you. Do you remember when you first learnt the Lord's Prayer? Anyone can get back that far? Learning to recite it off by heart, that sense of satisfaction that you're getting it right. I remember learning the Lord's Prayer in Sunday school, and there was incentive because the teacher had prizes for those who could get it right. You know how Sunday school teachers bribe the children? Maybe you got bribed in Sunday school as well. And I remember being very proud of the fact that I could do it. And I came home and I stood in front of my mom and dad. And I started, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hello, what's your name?" And yet, perhaps there is a moment of real truth in this. Because knowing the name of someone helps us to be able to greet them. What's the first thing you do when you meet a stranger? The first thing you do is exchange names. You give them your name and you listen for their name. In fact, names become really important. I remember I studied years ago at seminary with a friend. His name was Harry. And we went through all our seminary training in years, Harry. And then a few years later, when he got ordained, he kind of let it be known that he no longer wanted to be Harry. He wanted to be Harold. Because he said, "Pastor Harold just sounded a little more dignified than Pastor Harry." Because you see, names carry power. When somebody is introduced as His Excellency, or Her Majesty, or Your Worship, it carries huge power. Today's scripture is all about the power of a name. We read of how God confronted Moses in the desert, and you are familiar with the story, a burning bush, Moses being told, "Take off your shoes," Moses going to this burning bush, and as he gets there, realizes he's standing in the presence of God. And then Exodus 3 verse 9, God who says to Moses, "I have seen how the Egyptians oppress my people." And Exodus 3 verse 10, God telling Moses, "Go and tell Pharaoh to let my people go." And Moses, who answers God and says, "Are you crazy? Do you know who Pharaoh is?" So, do you know who Pharaoh is? Various scholars have tried to identify the Pharaoh that Moses spoke to. Some have suggested that Ramses II might be a good model for this story. Ramses, who ruled Egypt from 1279 to 1213. Ramses, who became Pharaoh at the age of 24 and ruled until he was 90. 66 years as Pharaoh. And the older he got, the more people believed him to be divine. The more people believed that this man surely must be, if not a god, then the god, because how else did he live so long? Ramses, who built his own city 60 miles northeast of present-day Cairo. Ramses, who had this enormous palace with two rooms. One room with a huge pillar in the middle, on which was carved all of Ramses's victories in battle. The other room, which had a huge statue of Ramses himself, 56 foot high. And you had to pass both of these rooms before you came into the presence of Pharaoh. Ramses, who over time became known as Ramses the Great. And then as the years passed, Ramses the Divine One. And then ultimately, Ramses the Great Ancestor. Now let's go back to Moses. Exodus 3 verse 10, the Lord says, "Come, I will send you to Pharaoh that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt." Here is God saying to Moses, "Go and tell Pharaoh that my people are declaring their Independence Day." And just to root it, let me play a little with this. Perhaps you might imagine Moses as Thomas Jefferson and Benjamin Franklin and John Adams. "Go and tell the king the people no longer want to be under your rule." And I can almost hear the silence settling over the desert as Moses tries to get his answer together. And eventually, you can almost hear it creaking out of reluctant vocal cords. "So let me get this right. I am to visit that magnificent palace of Pharaoh with the victories of all the enormous things he's done carved on the pillar and that huge statue. I am to go and see Ramses the Great, Ramses the Divine One, Ramses the Great Ancestor. And I'm to tell him that his people are leaving him for another god." Who exactly am I to tell him is sending me? Because I need a name, or I need some kind of grand title to impress him enough that he'll hold off from cutting my head off. And God answers. Exodus 3 verse 14. God says to Moses, "I am who I am. Say this to the people of Israel, I am has sent me to you." And if I can paraphrase, just do a little bit of theology. God says to Moses, "I will not compete with anyone else. I uniquely am God and nobody else. There is not a heaven full of gods, and you can take your pick which one you will choose to follow. There is only one divine being." And in fact, more to this, not only is God saying to this Pharaoh who has begun to be regarded as a god, not only is God saying, "I alone am the Holy One," God's also telling Moses to tell Pharaoh that he is to obey the God of Moses. Not only does Moses have to go to Ramses the Great and say, "There's a God who's greater than you," but my God is telling you to listen to him. At which point, Moses wets himself. Okay, the Bible doesn't quite put it like that, but Exodus 4 verse 13, Moses says, "Oh Lord, please send someone else." And you can understand why. I can almost see him looking around in the desert and hoping, is there not anyone else in this queue? Because I sure as hell don't want to do this. And I see in this the challenge to every generation. A challenge that's repeated throughout the Old Testament, repeated throughout the New Testament, and in the past 2,000 years of our Christian history. Like Moses, we have to choose to acknowledge God's authority over our lives and over the life of every other living thing, including the pharaohs who demand our allegiance. And maybe this weekend it's particularly poignant, because citizens of the United States celebrate Independence Day, and as a guest to your country, I wish you God's blessing in this celebration. But at the same time, I'm compelled by God to ask you the same question that Moses asked of Pharaoh. As much as you celebrate your independence, will you choose to recognize your dependence on God. You see, independence also requires an acknowledgement of dependence. The essence of those words in the Lord's Prayer, "Hallowed be thy name," literally means, I will surrender myself before the holy name of God. Hallowed be thy name. No other name shall come before God. No other Pharaoh comes before God. And I have prayed the Lord's Prayer many, many times, and I need to assure you, I no longer say, "Hello, what's your name?" because I've kind of figured that one out. But in saying, "Hallowed be thy name," every time I say it, I acknowledge my dependence on God. I've learned that in my own country, South Africa, as much as I respect my president, his name is President Cyril Ramaphosa, as much as I respect him, I cannot give the same loyalty to him that I give to God. In fact, my prayer is that my president will acknowledge that he'd been placed there by God and that he lives his life in obedience to the laws of God. Hallowed be thy name means that I choose God before I choose my president. Hallowed be thy name means I choose God before I choose the power of my history or the power of my culture or my race or my gender. Hallowed be thy name means I give up my rights, my freedoms, my independence, and choose to be led by God. And as an aside, it strikes me that just like Moses went to Pharaoh in the name of God, it is in the name of God that I serve as a pastor in the Methodist Church. It's in the name of God that I travel 10,000 miles to serve you. It is in the name of God that I choose to face the challenges of this COVID-19 virus alongside you. I shall not be afraid because God has sent me. That doesn't mean there aren't moments I'm saying, "Lord, couldn't you have sent someone else? Did I really have to arrive in this town at this time?" Because I'm human and sit with these people. No, I didn't say that. But my point being, it is in the name of God that I'm here because God has called me. And within this, I find a challenge and a promise. And I'd offer you the challenge and at the same time offer you the promise. The challenge for all of us to go from here in the name of God. To put God first in everything we do. Because obedience to God comes before our historical values, before our cultural norms, and before our family habits. Let's be clear, in case you're sitting here, not even quilting, or grandchildren, or football, or in my case, guitars, come before God. Does that make sense? Everything is offered to God. Everything can be used in God's service. Hallowed be thy name means God's holy name is above all. And obedience to God might also ask that, like Moses, we need to tell the pharaohs of this world that they must live their lives in obedience to God. And there are always those who want to act like Pharaoh. In our families, we have pharaohs. And maybe even as I say that, it comes to mind. Do you have a pharaoh in your family? Someone who wants to boss? No, don't nudge that person next to you. I'm talking to you. Someone who wants to boss everyone else around like they are pharaoh? And maybe at some point we need all to, maybe you are pharaoh. But we need to be reminded that we live under God. And we choose God's values. Hallowed be thy name. There are people in the workplace who try and be Pharaoh and try and dominate everybody else. Let's be reminded that even the Pharaohs in the workplace need to be held accountable to God's standards. There are people who try and impose their will on the city or on the state or on the country. And like Moses, we might need to tell these pharaohs, submit yourselves to the values of God. Before the political party, before the business interests, before nationalistic dreams, let us put God first. That's the challenge. Alongside the challenge is the promise. I offer to you Exodus 3 verse 12. Here's the promise. God says, I will be with you. You see, we don't go alone. When Moses faced Pharaoh, he was not alone because God was with him. When David faced Goliath, he was not alone because God was with him. When Jesus faced Pontius Pilate, he was not alone because God was with him. When St. Paul faced the Emperor of Rome, he was not alone. Krista, as you lead this congregation, you are not alone because God is with us. And even if you find some pharaohs in this congregation, it's okay. You're not alone. You can take them on. And when any of us have difficult choices to make, when any of us struggle with those things, hear God saying, I am who I am has sent you. Do not be afraid. The God of all creation has got your back. You are not alone. Hallowed be thy name. Let us pray that with conviction. Let's own it as part of our roots. The name of God is over us. And as we pray, hallowed be thy name, let's know that God has got our back. In Jesus' name. Amen. Have I said enough? I kind of think so. I think I've done it. I am going to invite us to bring our gifts to God. We're going to do it slightly differently. You will see there are baskets. There's one there. There's one over here. There is another one at the back. So, and there's another basket over there. So you can find the basket that's closest to you. And as we sing our next song, a song that speaks of the place of our faith, that the cross of Jesus is to be lifted high over all. As we sing this song, I invite you to bring your gifts. If you're at home, I invite you to bring your gifts. You can either give them online, or you can make a money transfer, or you can put it in the post. But before we bring our gifts, before we sing this song, let's just pray together and honor these gifts before God. Let us pray. Lord God, we bring our gifts to you. As we say to you, hallowed be thy name, we give these gifts as a sign of honoring you, a sign of our love for you. Thank you that you blessed us. May we in turn give gifts as a blessing to others. In Jesus' name, amen. So if you would lead us, you can find a basket that's convenient to you and place your gifts in the basket. You can give your gifts online at home.
Yeah.
these gifts are given in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. You can just stay here. I am going to lead us in a prayer. A prayer in which we pray for our church, we pray for our nation. There are one or two announcements which I'd like to make, which we then can include in our prayer, if I can just have them on the screen. There was notices for the screen, but that's fine. Just to take note that every Sunday we are producing a children's video as well. So you can go online. If you go and take a look at our website, you'll find there is a children's video for each week. So there is one for this 4th of July weekend. We invite you to go online. Secondly, to note that we have not stopped Wednesday night services. So if you go online, you will find a service every Wednesday night. We're looking at the Psalms. It's a series which we entitled Psalms for a Pandemic. But if you go on each Wednesday night from 6 o'clock, it is released, there will be a short Bible study and a time of worship. We will come back here next week, having learned from what happens this week. The invitation then to come back next week and get better at this. You guys are the pioneers. I think in months to come, you will look back and say, we're the ones who pioneered this and got it right. Can I also ask us to note there is a vacation Bible school which will take place. It will be a virtual VBS this year. Again, you can access it online. Go to our Facebook site or go to our website and you'll find the information there. You can then run VBS at home. You can get your neighborhood kids together if you feel comfortable with that. But the idea is we wanted VBS still to happen, so you can access it there. On your way out, you will find copies of this study. So if you can pick this up, or you will find copies of the Upper Room Devotional, and you can take that. So, let us pray together. For a moment, we're going to pray for our world and pray for the people we love. Gracious God, Creator of our world and giver of all life, we come to you to pray for the life of this nation. We celebrate the birth of this American nation and pray for all who have authority and influence in leading our nation. We pray for the president and the governor of this state. We remember the members of Congress and Senate. May your spirit lead them in ways of peace and kindness, that your holy name be honored. We come in prayer for the leaders of this city of Brookings and the leaders of the many other cities in this country and in the countries across the face of the earth. Grant our leaders wisdom and grace to serve our communities in God-honoring ways. Grant grace to all teachers and those who assist in our systems of education. Grant them patience and ingenuity as they develop new ways of sharing knowledge. Bless all healthcare workers with wisdom and strength. Give strength to caregivers and insight to those who are developing better ways of caring for those who get sick. And once again, we pray for those who are developing a vaccine for this virus, that we might find ways of protecting one another. We pause and remember those who have died. Give peace to those who grieve the loss of loved ones. We pray for our families, our friends, and our colleagues. Bless us all with the certainty of your loving strength, the knowledge that you go with us in our lives. And to all these prayers, we add our deepest longings. For in you, O Lord, we place our trust, and it is in that trust that we share together the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, for thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Amen. It is time to go home. We are going to sing a final hymn. Before we do so, I do want to say thank you to the team at the back who makes a service like this possible. To Paul Smith and to Sam Becker and Eric Tillickson and Drew Schnabel, thank you. Thank you from us. Thank you from all the guys at home. Really, really appreciate the time you put in. Thank you, Krista, for coming to join the team. I am uniquely privileged to join with you in this ministry. We are going to stand and we're going to sing together. It is appropriate that we affirm that amen to our faith. So if you guys would lead us, please. Let me offer a blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, may the love of God, and may the embracing strength of the Spirit go with us all today, through this week, and to eternity. little. The ushers will direct us out so that we don't all just cross over each other. Matt, I'm handing over to you. Oh, Kim, Matt.